Hi, Mom. Yeah, no, can you pick up Chris after school? Yeah, I'm at the doctor's.
Mrs. Harris?
Describe your symptoms.
Hang on. Stress, headaches, nausea. Well, I work on Saturdays.
And how long has this been?
Equanimity. Balance your lifestyle.
Good day. Is this Dr. Alyssa DeWeck?
Hi.
Hi. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
I want my audience to know that Dr. DeWeck is the Assistant Clinical Professor of OBGYN at Mount Sinai School of Medicine in New York. And she's going to tell us a little bit how to plan for the future as the average age of first-time moms in the U.S. continues to rise. Dr. DeWeck, I thought that was really interesting about the rising age.
I do too, and I've seen this in my practice as well, but we're seeing that the average age of when women have their first baby is now 26. This is higher than it's been in the past, and really attributable, at least in part, to the fact that so many women really want to further their careers, get their education under their belts, and, you know, deal with their professional lives prior to childbearing.
Now, let me ask you, and I know this is probably a different group. This does not segue to the teenage pregnancy rate being down, does it? Or is that a separate, like, study?
I think that's a separate issue, but I will make note that the options available for contraception have become vast, particularly the long-acting reversible contraceptives, such as the IUD. We call them LARCs, and the availability of education, options, and accessibility for these types of contraception has also contributed.
That sounds good. Are there any downsides to women waiting longer to have babies? Because I had someone on the show, she's 60 years old and she had twins.
Oh my, well that's certainly the exception rather than the rule. And I think it's really an individual decision for most women, their partners, their families, and they should make with the advice of their healthcare providers.
When you're looking at your birth care options, early stages, mid stages, towards the end of reproduction stages, how do you make these choices for your life?
Right. So different things arise at different times of your life, but it's great to know that there are multiple options. Certainly the birth control pill is one of the most common options. Now we have the LARCs available, specifically the IUD called Skyla, which is now indicated for young women who have not had children yet. And this is a safe, effective 3-year IUD. So this is a really nice option for our younger patients. In addition, I always like to make mention that the condom is really the only way to prevent infection, so that's something to keep in mind no matter what method you're choosing.
When we're doing our OBGYN business, some things have changed. I've even done an interview where they say the time schedule for the pap smear has changed or will change.
Yes.
So there's a lot of changes going on. How intimate should we be with our OBGYN?
Well, hopefully very intimate. We hope to see you yearly, despite the fact that pap smear guidelines have changed. But a yearly visit gives us the opportunity to discuss issues such as contraception, and we get to really mold things based on the time of life that women are in.
If there was one thing you want my audience to know from this conversation you and I are having, Dr. DeWeck, what would you leave them with?
Well, I think it's really important to speak to your individual healthcare provider about your contraceptive options and needs. And again, it's all very individualized, and we'll find something that's right for you, your partner, and your family, and in conjunction with your healthcare provider.
I always say it's never been a better time to be a woman on planet Earth. Dr. DeWick, thank you very much. Do you have a website for my audience?
Yes, please. For more information on the IUD that I mentioned, you can visit skyla-us.com.
Thank you so very much for this very important information, Dr. DeWick.
Thank you.
Really appreciate it.
You bet.